the guest of Samino.
Thank you for the fire.
Where were you before?
When?
This afternoon, I mean.
Wandering about?
I know, but where? Where were you just before?
Downtown shopping.
Here, you better have some coffee. I think it's still warm.
You're terribly direct in your questions.
Well, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to be rude.
You're not. You're merely direct. And what were you doing there at Old Fort Point?
Oh, just wandering about.
Oh, you like it too?
Yes.
And where had you been just before?
I'd been to the Palace of the Legion of Honor, the art gallery.
Oh, yes. It's a lovely spot, isn't it? Never been inside, but it looks so lovely driving past.
Absolutely. Have you guys done some Jimmy Stewart research since we've decided to do this?
Oh my God. Have I? That's the thing though. I'll have some stuff to talk about with the movies, but I have more to talk about.
Okay,
here's the thing too. I don't think you're gonna get sued for the slander that I am probably gonna put out there, but I'm drawing conclusions.
Oh, that's fine. We need a lawsuit. We need a lawsuit on this show, damn it.
Absolutely. No such thing as bad publicity.
But let me tell before we go in, there's a reason we're doing this. So years ago, mid-late 90s, you guys went to a college called IUP in Indiana, Pennsylvania. And I was sort of like a derelict, always roaming around, stayed with you guys once in a while. So for a short time, like Joe, you were first getting me into movies when working at the movie theater. Mm-hmm. You guys had a house across the street from Jimmy Stewart's childhood home. Indiana, PA is the hometown of Jimmy Stewart. And
we were down at the bottom of the hill. They were at the top.
Yeah. But you guys weren't that far from it. Because remember, it's kind of like 6 or 7 down. It wasn't like right across the street. But
it was
like
definitely the same neighborhood. Definitely the same neighborhood.
Right.
And he had a nice house.
Very nice house.
Yeah. Fucking back in the 30s, he was born when the 1910s or whatever. He's
1908, I think, or something like that.
God damn. Yeah, he's a little brat.
His house was literally at the top of the hill, and it was a big house. Okay, so I'm going to start getting into what I think of the Stewart family right now. Some of this isn't true. Some of it is. Some of it's my own putting two and two together. Here's the true stuff. So Jimmy Stewart's family had the hardware store. Ron, we know about the hardware store.
It was
an S&T Bank, I think.
Yes, you're correct.
So that was in the family. And when Jimmy wanted to become an actor, his dad's like, you know what? Come back home, work at the family hardware store. It's been in business for generations. So here's the thing. Jimmy went to Princeton. Jimmy was not a good student, but he got into Princeton. His dad went to Princeton.
Right.
Okay. So he works at, they have their hardware store. When Jimmy won his Academy Award, not the mayor, his dad had the entire town shut down so they could have a parade for Jimmy. His family was an organized crime family, is I guess what I'm getting at right now. They ran that city.
Okay? I subscribe to that. I subscribe to that. Yeah, you're right. He does run that. It seems like they ran that town.
Yeah. And the size of the house, the house was huge.
Yeah,
huge house was gargantuous. The hardware store, you think of like a little, mid-20s, 30s hardware store. It was 3 stories. It was the entire building was his hardware store. And I just learned this. I was doing a little research for this. Thank you, Vito. Joe, do you remember, Vito, there's that little, I don't know where, remember when you got into a fight with all those guys in that little neighborhood? Mm-hmm. There's a park there called Memorial Park. Do you know what I'm talking about? There's a statue of a doughboy, a World War I doughboy that Alex Stewart, his father, put up.
Oh, shit. Okay.
So he erected a big, huge bronze statue, little hardware store owner.
Yeah. And along those lines, though, too. So the statue, I'm gonna read you.
Is there a statue for Jimmy Stewart there, though, too?
Fuck yeah.
Okay. Ron, well,
did you not share the picture?
The statue is actually right across the street from where the hardware store was, and it's actually at the Indiana County Library, which is where the Jimmy Stewart Museum is, right on Philly Street.
Oh, I love it.
I can't believe, Ron, have you not shared the pictures with Vito yet?
I don't think I did.
What are these?
Okay. But I have to read you the most Western PA story about the statue. It's not even a story. This was a part of the news clipping that I found about it. And I was like, this is the most Western PA sentence I've ever seen. So let me get by it. Okay. So for Stewart's 75th birthday in 1983, his hometown of Indiana, Pennsylvania, honored him with a 9-foot-tall bronze statue. Unfortunately, the statue wasn't totally ready in time for his visit, so they presented him with a fiberglass version instead.
Yep. Do you know where that fiberglass version is?
You know where it is?
Yeah, I do. It's actually in the Jimmy Stewart Museum, like 5 feet from where that statue is. Yeah, they kept it.
He's like, I'm not going to need this.
Yeah, and it's on Jimmy Stewart Boulevard. They have also in Indiana, right?
Yeah,
that's the main. Yes. That's the main street.
Yep. And do you guys know a little fun fact about that? I'm trying to share my screen, but I don't know how to do it because I'm a fucking idiot. But do you know that the street there is, it's actually called Philadelphia Street as well. That's like its formal title.
Okay.
They have, it's at a college town, not that it matters, but they have like street lights and crosswalks at the intersections, but they have audio cues for anybody that's visually impaired. Joe, have you been up there lately?
I have not.
So if you go to the corner of Philly Street and South 7th Street, where like that 700 shop is and all that there, right in the middle of the center, they actually have the audio cues to say it's safe to walk, don't walk, whatever they say. And it's in the voice of Jimmy Stewart.
Jesus Christ.
But they did this after Jimmy Stewart died. Do you know who the actual voice on the recording is?
Who?
Rich Little, the comedian.
That's fucking great.
The impressionist. Yeah. Yeah. So if you go up there right now,
every time Rich Little goes,
it says safe to walk, don't walk, whatever, in Jimmy Stewart's voice. Voiced by Rich Little.
That's gonna be so annoying though. You're standing there, walk, you know.
Yep.
A little Rich Little got the call. And they're like
anytime somebody's dead now? Though, I think Rich Little gets the call, you know.
Yeah.
No, but I do like that. I do agree with you about his family being, you know, connected somehow, because that area always had something going on. In the beginning of film, like the Kennedy family, like there was like a big mafia influence on movies, and that wouldn't surprise me at all. Like he gets his kid in Princeton, and you know, he was kind of goofy. He was this lanky, skinny, kind of funny looking dude, and you know, he became like arguably like a Mount Rushmore Hollywood face. That's not an accident. Absolutely.
Did you see his measurements when he first tried to get in the military?
No.
I did. Yeah.
I know Ron. That's the first thing. So to his credit, but I'm going to say some more stuff later on that's why I want to qualify for this. He was the first Hollywood actor that said, I want to go to war.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Problem is he did it before the U.S. had ever declared war. I didn't know that piece.
When he showed up
and they weighed him, so Jimmy Stewart's 6'3". He was 138 pounds.
God damn.
Wow.
They told him, like, we can't take you. Now, by the way, this is another thing, too. There's, like, a bunch of Jimmy Stewart fan lists out there. Like, most of the stuff I got was from these people who celebrated Jimmy Stewart. And they were talking about how he went home to Indiana. And his mom filled him full of pancakes and grits, so like whatever the fuck, they really tried to say he could bulk up. But actually, the story I heard was he next time he went to go get weighed, he took weights with him so that he could be heavier. That's how he got into the military, which I think is actually a cooler story.
I know, absolutely. But you got to give him credit. He like went to war for like 5 years, like, and he actually like fought. There was only a few actors they said actually were like in real battles, like Walter Matthau, Jimmy Stewart, like a few guys were actually like did it, you know. And so like, and that was the only thing I ever wanted to talk about was like, you can tell the one thing I noticed is like that separation in his career is like that with that 5 years he went missing. When he comes back, he had those like really shitty Frank Capra, Mr. Smith Goes to Washington type of movies. But when he came back, he was actually like pretty awesome. That's when the Hitchcock movies came and Anthony Mann, the Westerns and all that shit. Like he was definitely a different actor when he came back.
So I always was, and I did this when Mr. Rogers died too. I tried to see if I could dig up dirt. So the first thing I did look up was, was he part of the bombing of Dresden? Do you guys know what the bombing of Dresden was?
No.
That's the one thing that no one really, like, this was the U.S., and Dresden was a city in Germany that was basically the artistic hub of all of Europe. It was this beautiful city, you know, and it was one of these, but, and it was all civilians too. And we did a bombing raid over it that basically created an inferno. It was like a vacuum of fire. Everybody in that city got burned to death. It was like, they said it was worse than Hiroshima and everything too.
Oh, damn.
He was almost, but he was not a part of that raid. Because I was like, but he was a part of another one that apparently fucked him up for the rest of his life. Like, they said he suffered from severe PTSD.
Oh, wow.
And I'm not going to look up the name of the city, but they did a bombing run into a city. So he saw his friends get killed flying the missions, but he also knew what he was doing too. You know, he's a very religious guy too. So he knew what, like, what was part. So when he saw the bombs drop, it really had a big effect on him too. And kind of more to your point, he became a much darker guy post-war than he was pre-war, you know, because I agree with you. Mr. Smith Goes to Washington is insufferable.
Frank Capra is the most overrated director of all time, except for those war propaganda movies he did. Everything else is just garbage.
But Stewart's first movie when he came back was It's a Wonderful Life.
You're right.
Yeah. So he flew this mission over the city over in Germany too. It really kind of screwed him up for the rest of his life. But the thing is, though, he refused to talk about his PTSD because at that time, it was still an era that if you were affected by, which all of them were, but if you couldn't hide it, then you were a coward. So, and he was already kind of considered, you know, kind of a goofy, you know, skinny weakling kind of guy. You know, he was always kind of this goof that, you know, he also was afraid of his career, kind of what that would do too. So he became like, because I would say Jimmy Stewart he has two of my favorite movies, which is Rear Window and Vertigo. And yeah. I would even say that Rear Window might be one that's like top five for me too.
Yeah, yeah.
But he also has Mr. Smith Goes to Washington and fucking It's a Wonderful Life. I'm like, it's feast or famine with him.
I'm the same way with you. Yeah, that was one of the things I wanted to talk about. Like, how could he be so great and then so different, so two sides of him. Yeah,
I know. Yeah, that late 50s run he had was great. Like, you know, I don't know if you guys ever saw like the Man Who Shot Liberty Valance.
That's one of my favorite movies. I love that movie. Here's the thing about that. I don't want to sidetrack this.
Oh, go ahead.
But it's kind of one of the things I want to talk to you guys about with the movies, because that's one of my favorite movies. But I don't even know if I consider that a true Jimmy Stewart movie. I mean, you got John Wayne, Lee Marvin, you got all these the supporting cast, and that was amazing.
Yeah.
And Jimmy Stewart really wasn't all that great in it. In my mind, the movie itself was awesome.
Right. And that movie seemed to get really famous because of the whole print the legend thing that John Ford created. That's like the whole, yes. I don't know. You're kind of right. What I always thought was funny about it was like, John Wayne, you know, it's like you have Lee Marvin who served in the military. You have Jimmy Stewart who served, and they're all like little punks to John Wayne who could beat everybody up. He dodged the war. He just bitched out his.
He was such a pussy. I know.
Such a pussy. It probably burned like Jimmy Stewart, Lee Marvin a little bit. They probably had to give each other little smirks, like every time John Wayne was like gloating around doing his thing, you know.
Not demeaning his
Hollywood standing. John Wayne was huge, but Jimmy Stewart, like, I mean, I went into this air museum with my buddy Mike Bates, and we saw the original Strategic Air Command plane that they had and that they used for the movie, but that Jimmy Stewart knew how to fly and everything. And it was fucking crazy, like the inside of that plane. Like, it wasn't a normal fighter plane, like just all the controls and everything. It's nuts to see it. Like, I can see why.
He was a real deal pilot. He had his commercial and private license before the war even broke. He had in the mid-30s. He just wanted to be a pilot.
I didn't know that.
So he could fly. Yeah. And that's when because that was the thing too. Like, if you look at his background, so he, like, again, he went like 39. He was like, I'm ready to go. And they're like, it's wait 2 years. So he didn't, you know, the war didn't really start for America at 41. And he enlisted immediately. And they did not put him into combat till 43. They, like, he wanted to go in 41 and they grounded him. And because they were like, I would guess is because they waited till the war kind of flipped. They didn't want to send Jimmy Stewart out there against the Luftwaffe and he gets blown out of the sky within 10 minutes. So they waited.
Yeah.
The advantage flipped a little bit too, but he was apparently a great pilot.
It's just weird how like his career flopped. But yeah, he did switch like that. Cause he did all those Hitchcock movies, and it's not just those two. Have you ever seen Rope?
No.
No.
It's a really good, they play like it's, they don't say it, but it's like they're gay characters, the two guys. And like, they're not allowed to say it back then, but like you kind of imply it, but it's all done in like one take. And the camera will like pan in. It's like, you know, Hitchcock always had a trick he tried to do, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's one of those movies, but I thought it was great. I really loved it.
You said it was called Rope.
Rope, yeah. So it's like they have a dead body inside, like in this whatever in their living room. They put it, and it looks, they turned it into this little table. They put a body on. They cover up with like a sheet to make it look like a coffee table. So they have a party, and inside this, and like there's a dead body in the middle of this party, and everyone's like walking around talking, putting their drinks on the table, and it's just the two guys always staring at the body, and it's really good.
God damn, that sounds awesome.
Yeah,
that sounds different.
Yeah,
Jimmy Stewart. Because that's the thing. Yeah. Jimmy Stewart always gets painted as like kind of this, and he was, you know, the American Pie. You know, that was Jimmy Stewart his entire life. But he had that. He had a weird. He liked weird movies. He wasn't somebody that just did this like cookie cutter type shit, which he could have and been much richer. But he kind of went after the quirkier shit.
Did you guys ever hear of the, because him and Henry Fonda were really good friends. Mm-hmm. And did you ever hear about like the fight they had?
Yes, I was hoping you were going to go back.
My buddy Mike was telling me about it because he's a pretty good like film historian in his own right. And he knows a lot about Western movies history. But he was telling me about like, so they got really drunk one night and Henry Fonda is a liberal and they just start talking about the war and politics and they got into an all out fist fight. And then the next day, they just promised never to talk about politics again, and then they were fine.
Yeah, they say they were. So I'm going to read you the saddest two bits from IMDb trivia, just based off of what you just said, because I was like, oh shit, this is because they have to put these one after another. So the one on top was Gary Cooper considered Stewart to be his closest friend, and then the very next one. His best friend was probably Henry Fonda. Oh, by the way, Walter Matthau was in Jimmy Stewart's unit.
No shit.
I didn't know that either. Oh, wow.
That's fucking crazy. I never knew that.
Wow.
Yeah.
Huh. Oh, wow. Oh,
that's some good trivia there. Those guys are probably some badasses.
No doubt.
So I will tell you with Jimmy Stewart, I you know, we make fun of IUP, but that is really where I found Rear Window and Vertigo was my art of film class, which was the book I gave to you, which is what you started looking at.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. God, that's kind of crazy.
Huh. Well, Jimmy Stewart, we, you know, we have the thing for this. God damn it.
I love that. I hope, I don't know if this is the case. I hope the professor, like he was required to do at least one Jimmy Stewart movie in his syllabus.
I wouldn't doubt that.
Mandatory. Have you guys ever heard that poem he did about his dog?
I heard of it, but I never read it.
Heard of this about him. They said that he was, except for he couldn't do it in public for some reason. He was one of the funniest people when you were just hanging out with him. But like if the camera was in front of him or he was at the celebrity roast or whatever, he just couldn't get it out or, you know, but he always was either really sentimental or really funny, but he just didn't know. He just, you know, had this Jimmy Stewart always. Front and center. Yeah. But he was on Johnny Carson one time, and I guess his dog Beau, but his dog passed away or whatever, and he had a poem he read about his dog, and like Johnny Carson's trying not to cry. It was like really funny. I was like, Jesus Christ.
Oh, wow.
I learned so much about Jimmy Stewart in this. That was incredible.
Didn't he publish a book of poetry?
Oh, he sure did. Jimmy Stewart and his poems.
Oh, my God.
The man could do it all.
Still have me sold on this mafia thing with his family. I almost would have deeped into his family's background even more in the beginning of them settling in Indiana and how they got to Indiana to begin with.
I get it. That's probably an unbelievable story, too. But I'm going to give you a background, probably why he showed up so early to go to war. He is Lieutenant Dan because his grandfather fought in the Civil War for the Union. His dad fought in World War I, beat back the Kaiser. Jimmy was like, well, fuck it. This is my right. I got to go and fight now, too. That was the family line. But they had been in Indiana that entire time, too. It's Boss Stewart. I guarantee you there was like a Boss Stewart where he ran that fucking. And that's why they were telling him, it's like, you got to come back to Indiana, Jimmy. You don't want to.
Did he ever come back? I remember, wasn't it like 1986 or 89? They tried to do like that
83
when they did like the big anniversary thing for It's a Wonderful Life. Remember, wasn't it in the 90s maybe?
Vice versa. His 75th birthday was when they did the statue. And that was the last time Jimmy Stewart was in Indiana. That was okay. 83.
I remember they invited him one time towards the end. He didn't show up. And I remember we were all laughing about it.
we were there in 96 when it was the 50th anniversary of It's a Wonderful Life.
That's it. Okay. They invited him to that and he didn't come.
Yeah.
He talks so much bullshit about how Indiana. I mean, I'm not going to bore anybody with what his numerous speeches about Indiana, Pennsylvania, but he literally. That was the only time he went back in all those years. I mean, I don't blame him, to be honest with you.
In 96, I was working at Chestnut Ridge bartending, and they actually had a humongous party for the 50th anniversary. And I actually met his granddaughters at that party.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I was bartending. We bullshitted for like, you know, a minute while we're waiting at the bar and stuff. They were pretty cool. They were young at the time, but they were hoping Jimmy was going to be there at the party.
Oh, they lived there locally.
No. They brought him in. Yeah, I think the city of Indiana or something. I forget who threw the party, but it was a huge party. And basically, they were the attraction, the granddaughters. Yeah.
Jimmy's not here, but we do have the granddaughter.
Yeah, that's pretty much what it was. Yep.
I just picture these two girls dressed up exactly the same with like pigtails in.
We're Jimmy Stewart's granddaughters.
Yeah, I just picture the two girls from The Shining just standing there.
He never went back to that goddamn town. He's like, I'm living in Hollywood. I'm never going back. But I can't tell you the extremely sad reason why he didn't come back.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So when his wife died, he was literally just waiting to die. He wouldn't leave his bedroom.
I did hear that.
Yeah. His cleaning people would come in and his maids were like, you need to eat something. So they would force him to come eat. And okay. So here's the other thing that's probably slanderous to say about Jimmy Stewart. He had multiple instances where he tripped and split his head open. It's my contention, because of when all these happened, he was trying to kill himself, and he kept trying to do it to a way where nobody would know he tried killing himself. So he kept falling and smashing his head into things. It happened more than one. Now, granted, there's going to be people that say that happens with old people all the time. Like, yes, but for my story, I think that was his way of trying to say, I'm out of here, because he actually did tell them, I just want to die right now. And he didn't die till like 97. That's why he didn't show up. After his wife died, he refused to go out. He never really went out in public after that. It was like 2 years.
When did his wife die? What year was that?
95.
Oh, so he lived a couple more years then.
And I got confused because his wife was Gloria Stewart. So I thought it was the woman from Titanic, but I realized that didn't make any sense. So that it was just a coincidence.
I bet you Jimmy bagged some ladies back in the 30s, though, because he didn't get married till he got older. So I bet you.
His 40s. And do you want me to tell you? So it's just one line, though, too. But I didn't know this about old Jimmy.
Oh, yeah.
Let me want to say he was considered. I have a Word document pulled up. Give me one second. I got to find it real quick. Hold on. But Jimmy Stewart and I think Gary Cooper. Oh, yeah. It was him and I think Gary Cooper. They were roommates, and he was considered the great American bachelor by the press.
Mm-hmm.
That was Jimmy Stewart. Like, until his 40s, like all the way up until he got married, and he was, which it does not equate when you see a 6'3", 138-pound man, and he's just slaying it up and down Hollywood Boulevard.
Yeah.
Because Ron, that his dimensions are, remember Pete?
Yeah.
That's his dimensions. He was 6'3", 130 pounds.
Oh my God. He's gangly as hell. Wow.
If you guys ever see the Philadelphia Story with Cary Grant.
Yes.
He's literally like portrayed as like the handsome, good looking guy, even over almost Cary Grant. I was just like, get the fuck out of here. Like Cary Grant was like George Clooney. I was like, don't give me no shit on Stewart being like that. Come on now.
Wow.
Especially since he was already wearing a toupee.
Oh, really?
Stewart was?
Oh, I know I've told you this story.
I knew later in life he had a toupee on, but not when he was younger. I didn't know.
You can do an image search on this. You can do it.
I don't want to.
I think you need to, because you need to see him and you need to see John Wayne's bald.
I didn't even see John Wayne. I did see John Wayne. I did see John Wayne.
Yeah. They're bald patterns like mine, you know, where it's like really far back. It looks like Gabe Bathroom. But in It's a Wonderful Life, remember the scene where he's running down the middle of the street saying, Mary? Well, I guess he jumped down from someplace. And when he did that jump down, the wig falls off. You can search images online. You can find, because it's a one still of what
Fake. Oh, fuck. I'm going to check that out. That's awesome.
That's so great.
Wow. And I will say this, though, like, because he's mostly, you know, attached with, like, you know, our age of people. He's attached with Hitchcock, you know, those movies, which are awesome, you know, Vertigo, Rope, and Rear Window. But, like, you should, you know, besides the John Ford ones he's done, were pretty good. You know, there is a director, Anthony Mann, and he did some movies with him around the same time in the, like, late 50s, early 60s. Have you guys ever heard of Winchester 73?
I've never seen any of these, but I've heard of
it. I've seen that.
Okay. That's a really good one. It's like those late 50s, early 60s movies. He has like all these Westerns and like, I think they're actually really good.
I like his Westerns. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that really is what kind of launched him too. That post World War II, where he just started hitting and everything he made was just money. There was a site I went to which could show you the money he was making for movies and the escalation of it. And early 50s is where it went from 50 grand to 350 grand, like overnight. Yeah. The only movie where he made 50 grand again in the 50s was Spirit of St. Louis, just because he wanted to be in it, because he didn't know that Charles Lindbergh was this weird eugenics guy yet. And so I don't think America knew yet that this was not a guy you want to idolize. But since he was a pilot, Charles Lindbergh was a hero. So he won Charles Lindbergh. But...
Oh, okay. When did his dad die? The boss?
I don't know. In my research, I did not find that. His dad was alive when he won the Oscar.
Okay.
It was for the Philadelphia story, right?
Yeah.
So do you know the story of where that ended up?
I do. No. Yeah.
Is this an Indiana story?
Go ahead, Joe.
It's a short one. His dad called him. Was just like, so I hear you won something out there. Was it some kind of plaque? His dad didn't watch it. Well, they didn't watch the ceremony back then. It was like,
they didn't televise it until later.
So he told his dad what he won. So his dad's like, well, send it over. I'll put it up in the shop. So he put it in the hardware store. That's where it was for 25 years.
That's pretty cool, actually.
I love that. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's so fucking crazy.
Can I ask a cinematic question?
Yes.
Go for it.
Of the audience here. So one of my favorite Jimmy Stewart movies is Harvey. I love that movie.
Oh, okay. Yeah, the bunny one, right?
Yeah. To me, it freaked me the fuck out because it was so weird. And that picture haunts my nightmares. That painting, if you remember.
Yeah. Yep.
You guys know me. I'm a pretty simple. If it's on the surface, I see it. If it's not on the surface, I don't really give a shit. Is there something more to that? Like, what the hell was that?
So I want to watch it again. Anything that's like that, I always, now it was made like, I don't know, late 40s, early 50s, right? I always thought that was like a giant, it was like a 6-foot rabbit. So I always just thought it was like about drugs or like, anytime there's like a walking animal that talks and does stuff, I always think it's a drug metaphor somehow. But I don't know, but you're right. It's almost freaky.
Yeah. To me, there almost has to be another story, because if there's not, the surface story is fucked up. It's just weird. So I'm hoping there's another story behind it, like a drug something. I don't know.
Maybe. I have no idea. I've never seen Harvey. I've never seen Harvey, though.
It's pretty cool. I like it. I think it's a good movie.
Donnie Darko?
What's that?
Was that Donnie Darko had the bunny? Was that a reference to?
It may have been. I don't know. But definitely Harvey was the first time anyone's done, like, at least that I know of, someone's done something like in a mainstream movie, like something absurd with an animal like that, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And I kept waiting for like the punchline. There never was one. Imaginary rabbit.
Yeah. I'll give him credit for willing to be, I mean, especially in the 1950s, he was willing to do something weird. And by the way, that's not his favorite. His favorite movie is It's a Wonderful Life. That's his favorite.
Oh, it is. Okay.
Yeah. But he said he loved The Rabbit. He loved, like, he talked, he said that was like a really big high point for him doing that movie.
That's crazy.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like you said, Joe, he was the only actor in Hollywood doing something like that.
Yeah.
It wasn't a Western or a war movie. I mean, this was a fucking weird movie.
Yeah. Anatomy of a Murder is really good like that, too. He plays a lawyer. It's really good. A good movie.
Wasn't that like 3 hours long? Though?
Yeah.
I've seen him.
It's fucking, it's so long. I'm like, Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
But it's all right. I mean, that's not worth a watch. It's actually on Criterion right now. That's the only Jimmy Stewart on Criterion.
Yeah, I liked it though. I did like it though. It was a good like kind of procedural type movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What was your fact you were saying before you had?
Oh yeah, Jesus Christ! What was going to be my Jimmy Stewart fact for you? Oh, okay. Fun fact: Jimmy Stewart, number one, It's a Wonderful Life. He was not the first choice. Do you know who the first choice was? It was the person who considered him his best friend.
Gary Cooper.
But apparently Jimmy Stewart didn't consider him.
No way.
See, poor Gary Cooper.
And that would be a very different movie. I would argue a better movie as the lead.
Why?
Grizzled guy. Mm-hmm. When you see Gary Cooper, he looks like a guy who's lived a life, you know? And I think that role in It's a Wonderful Life, you know, granted, he was this, you know, do-gooder and he was trying to get loans for everybody, too. But I would have to expect that a guy had a lot of stress would look like Gary Cooper, not like Jimmy Stewart. Jimmy Stewart, even during kind of like, you know, his worst moments, still seems like he's got his shit together.
You know, like, yeah, I see that. Yeah.
Except, and that was the other thing, too. I don't think I'll find the picture, too, but there was an ad lib, I guess I'll give credit to the one good scene in It's a Wonderful Life. But when he's at the bar and he has kind of this, you know, speech to his wife and how he's not coming home, he just started crying on his own. And Frank Capra did not know it was going to happen, obviously, but he kept the camera rolling and they're like, shit, we got to do this again, because they didn't have a close up. And so they were like, we can't do it, because it was the first take. And they're like, we can't do that again because everybody's going to know it's fake now. It only works
right.
So real. So if you watch the movie, the scene where they show him in the bar and he's crying, it's very grainy looking. It's because Frank Capra had them zoom in on that medium shot. So there's one little bit.
I know what you're talking about. Yeah. Yep. I hate that when they do that. Yeah.
No. Oh, wow.
Yeah. It happens in so many old movies, too. You see it all the time where you're watching a movie and all of a sudden there's this weird close up that doesn't work. It doesn't match. And it's because the editor or somebody thought they needed a close up and they take a normal shot and they zoom in and it looks like shit. And only the editor thinks it looks good. So
I'm going to argue, though, that there is something about that that makes movies better, because just because you have these people who really shouldn't be put in charge of anything, that they're making these big decisions in multi-million-dollar movies. And sometimes you get to see beauty like that, where somebody's like, I want a close-up, goddammit. And so they have to put it in.
Oh, that's insane. I haven't seen that in years, but I know exactly the shot you're talking about, too. That's funny.
Yeah. Jimmy Stewart is full of all kinds of interesting facts. 99% of it, though, is him fighting in the war. However, you know how a lot of celebrities will use that celebrity to, you know, fight for a cause? Jimmy Stewart did the same thing back in the 80s, and I don't think he gets enough credit for it, that Jimmy Stewart went to Congress to get them to, he wanted them to stop, Ted Turner to stop colorizing movies.
I remember that.
Congress.
Yes, that is Congress fucking awesome. Yes. Yes.
That was his Mr. Rogers moment.
That is so funny. You know, a couple years ago, I went to this screening. They had some kind of restoration thing for Fistful of Dollars. And they had all these people there that were talking. And Jane Fonda was one of them. And they were talking about like black and white movies and everything. And everyone was giving all this money into like restoration of old classics. And she's like, well, since my favorite ex-husband colorized and ruined every great movie, I figured I have to give my money to save these movies now. But I remember we were little, that was like the most bastardizing thing ever. It was like, what the fuck is this colorizing? Oh,
because it didn't look natural. Like,
never look good. Never look good.
The shit they did for, and Ron, I don't know if you saw, but I know you did the documentary. They will remain young, or they will not grow old.
Yeah.
They will not grow old. The one about World War One. They colorized that. But it was done much better, I guess. It didn't look so
You know, great. There's something about like actual footage when you call it. Like, I don't mind if I'm watching like a World War II documentary and they colorize some footage. Not that it looks that much better, but like it looks better. But like at least they're trying to give you a different view of like actual footage. But when they do it to a movie, the whole point of the movie is to be in black and white. You know, at least war footage or actual footage, it could be in color. It doesn't matter. It's just the film they had. But the movie's supposed to look like that. I remember Turner Classic Movies did it to, I think it was Maltese Falcon or Casablanca. Casablanca was the first one. And I remember we were in Delmont River watching like the commercial, and I was like, what the fuck? And I was like, you know, fucking little kid. I was even like, ugh.
Well, even when they didn't colorize. Even when they didn't colorize it, like go back to TV. This always freaks me out. I don't know if I might be standing alone here, but the Andy Griffith Show, you know, it was black and white. Then one season they were able to shoot color. And they had like fucking like lime green walls. And I was like, what the hell are you doing? It didn't work for me. The black and white made it feel some more homey, you know?
Yeah, no, 100%. I saw a picture of the set of the Addams Family, and it's like all pink and all these you know, Barbie colors and everything. And it's like, it just looks good in black and white. You don't fuck with that, you know? And it's so weird.
Yeah. You know, Ron, you brought up television. So did you guys know that there were two different attempts to make Jimmy Stewart have his own series?
I wanted to ask about that because I know of it, but again, I've never seen any of it, but I knew of it.
Never heard, never seen him. The first was the Jimmy Stewart Show. And it's so, because most of the sites I went to were fan sites. Nobody elaborated it beyond, it couldn't find an audience. So, and his next one was what I would say was the original Matlock. And he was a small town lawyer defending people. Like, it was basically going to be Matlock.
Is that the Hawkins show?
Hawkins, that's it. Hawkins.
Yeah. I want to see that so bad. Isn't there like four episodes or something?
both shows. I think the Jimmy Stewart Show made it like third. They didn't see the end of the season.
Oh, I love that. I want to see Hawkins so bad. I've heard of that before.
Andy Griffith's just like, let me show you how it's done. Right? Yeah.
Exactly.
Andy is probably watching that like, God damn it. Yeah, the last great thing, I remember I looked up the filmography, and like the last movie that I loved that he did, his last actual performance, he was a voice in Five Will Goes West, the cartoon movie, 1991. Yeah. But like his last great movie for me is, I'm like one of the few on this one, but so the Humphrey Bogart movie, The Big Sleep, I actually prefer the Robert Mitchum, The Big Sleep, to that. I actually like his version better, the one that Michael Winner directed. That when Philip Marlowe is actually Robert Mitchum. The General Sternwood character is Jimmy Stewart in that one, and that's his last great movie, in my opinion.
That I will say. So this is okay. This is what I would say. I wish we had Mitchum in the Bogart version, even though I know that's probably everybody's like, but Bogart and McCall, but I mean, Mitchum, is just, you put him in anything.
I mean, I'm already kind of slow as it is. So when you watch a movie like The Big Sleep, the original has like no plot whatsoever other than just madness happening. Like, I get confused anytime I watch that movie, like the Bogie and McCall one.
Raymond Chandler did not know who killed the chauffeur. He wrote the book and the screenplay. They called him up to say, hey, who murdered the chauffeur? He's like, how the fuck should I know?
Wasn't he just a nasty drunk, too? And he didn't even pay attention when he was writing, and he just fucking drank the whole time.
And most of the movie was them just adding. They made him. I love what they did in the 40s. They locked the drunk in the house, and they told him, we need pages. When they realized that those two were hit kind of connecting, they're like, we need more of that. So that's why they had so many scenes together, was because of Chandler was forced to write more of the movie. It was going to be more of a straightforward type of Maltese Falcon type of movie. And then they made it something different from there.
Oh, okay. Yeah, near the end, like late 70s, I love The Big Sleep. And then he was in one of the airport movies. Those are my favorite disaster movies, is the airport series.
I've never seen any of the airport series.
They are fucking hilarious. They're probably on Amazon Prime. It's Airport, and Airport 75, Airport 77, Concorde. Yeah. Like, there's all these ones. But he was in Airport 77. And that was, I think, the last one out of all of them.
He wanted to show Gloria he still had it.
Oh, yeah.
In this big action movie, Gloria, you're going to see.
Oh, yeah. Airport movies are great. Oh,
my God. I've always wanted to see those. Is OJ in those?
He was in. I know he's in Towering Inferno. I don't know if he was in 77.
I think that's what I'm thinking of.
Yeah, Tower Inferno he was in. He was not in Air. I know he wasn't in the 70s. That the one with Jimmy Stewart, he was not in.
Can I just give you a name of a Jimmy Stewart movie? It might have been a play. I don't know. It's called The Gorgeous Hussy.
I need a t-shirt with that on it.
Have you guys ever seen, I guess it's only cool if you see on a big screen or even see like the new Blu-ray, but How the West Was Won?
No.
So like that was actually done in like the Cinerama thing where they actually have three cameras shooting at once. So it was actually made to like you're supposed to sit in a theater and there is on your left, there's a screen, on your right, there's a screen, and in the middle, there's a screen. So it's like you're surrounded by it. So now if you watch there's only like five movies that were made like an original Cinerama camera. So now if you buy like a Blu-ray or whatever, it's not like a straight line going across your screen. It's kind of like curved so you can catch it all. And it's this giant epic movie, and it had like three different directors, but Jimmy Stewart was in that one. And I always loved it because it was such a PA movie, in my opinion, because it was his scenes were with Carol Baker. Do you guys know who Carol Baker is? She's from Johnstown. She was in Giant. She was in just tons of big movies. She's still alive. She's like an icon, but she's from Johnstown. He's from Indiana. And I've always loved that those two were in that movie together.
That's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
How have I not heard that 8,000 times living in Johnstown?
I know. I mean, Carol Baker, Carol Baker, look her up. She is absolutely she is huge. Last time I think she's still alive, but the last time I think we saw her in something big, she was in David Fincher's movie, The Game, with Michael Douglas.
Okay.
She was his housekeeper or whatever at his house, but she had a few scenes with him. But I always loved that. I always loved that.
Oh, I know Carol. I know Carol.
Yeah, yeah. She's a fucking huge.
Yeah, she was centered in Silence of the Lambs.
Yes. No, no, no. That's not Carol Baker in Silence of the Lambs. That is, what's her name?
Diane Baker.
Yeah.
I thought the two biggest celebrities coming out of Johnstown were the Hanson brothers. That's all they celebrate here. Fucking the Hanson brothers.
That's like Indiana turned its nose at Johnstown because like we have Jimmy Stewart. Who do you have?
Oh man, yeah, it's like she's like a real prize because those two, I mean, it's so weird because like Carol Baker and Jimmy Stewart, like both of those two were like, they weren't just like kind of famous, like especially Jimmy Stewart, like they were like fucking like mega stars. It's nuts.
Oh wow.
So I almost started reading off the facts of a different actress that I thought I had Carol Baker, and I looked up, it was Carol Baxter. I finally got to Carol Baker. So I was like,
she was killed in the Amazon. Yeah.
Do you guys know Carol Baxter's work? Well, let me tell you something.
Stewardess Skull. Slumber Party Massacre.
Okay. So I want to bring up another fact about Jimmy Stewart. I do kind of want to get thoughts about this too. Because I've always been very, you know, obviously, my politics lean a certain way, you know, and you know, people that do are more conservative. I've always been a little bit more open-minded about that, and especially guys from that era, because most of them, they had family members that fought in the Civil War when, if you were a Republican, you're actually the good guy, you know. So, you know, with Jimmy Stewart, God, where the fuck was I going with that? Sorry.
I mean, you sound like me, like I'm always smoking weed and I forget what I'm saying halfway through the sentence.
I know. Yeah, guess what finally got legalized here? So that's what you guys are going to have to deal with right now. Nice. There was a point of, now I know where I was going with it. Okay, so because of that, you know, I tend to be a little bit forgiving because, you know, it was a different world. However, when you get to post-World War II, that's when you started to see some tendencies pop up. And one of the things that Jimmy Stewart never took any heat for was the blacklist hearings. He was for naming names.
Yep.
He encouraged it. He, you know, because, well, that clip of Orson Welles talking shit on Atlanta.
Yeah, I love that.
Amazing.
Yeah.
And I'm like, Stewart never had to pay the price for this.
I think the fact that, my thing on that is, I think people like Kazan and Sterling Hayden and people who took shit for naming names, that was because like the double standard, you know, these were like liberals who were ratting on people like, you know, Rod Taylor and Ronald Reagan and Jimmy Stewart, like you knew where they stood and you knew they were naming names. You know?
actually, Ronald Reagan, you didn't. He was an informant that didn't name names. That was what he got for not naming names. The FBI.
Yeah, you're right. I'm sorry. Informant. Yep.
Ron, do you have an opinion?
Not really. I don't know that much about it.
No. I am of the mind that, you know, because I'm always go back and forth, like there was a time and a place, and especially that, you know, nobody knew what a communist really was. All they got was what they heard from McCarthy and all them too. Mm-hmm. So I do understand that.
Yeah. Yeah.
However, there were enough guys that didn't say a goddamn thing and had just as much to lose, and they didn't. And, you know, I think.
Which is Gary Cooper, actually. I read The Making of High Noon, which is basically Carl Foreman, who wrote the script to that. It was one of the blacklisted writers. And that whole movie is a metaphor for the blacklisted.
Yeah.
And, you know, Gary Cooper, who's a conservative, he's like a bleeding heart conservative. He's a Republican who liked everybody. He was always like, no, Carl's a great writer and he's the writer of this movie, even though if it was like John Wayne, he'd be like, get that fucker off the you know, so it's until recently, everyone got along, you know. I mean, Steve McQueen was a right winger, so was Lee Marvin, but they'd hang out at everybody being cool. Only recently it's like, you know, people don't mesh as well as they used to.
Coke and sex brought people together like nothing else.
That's right. That's right. But it's kind of fun. We were talking about the blacklisting in movies, talking about Kazan. It's like, you know, it's cool. You see, you know, watching On the Waterfront, you see, you know, how a lot of directors up until this day with Scorsese, you see directors like putting it in their movies that it's okay to rat. And then you see people like Kubrick in like Spartacus with had Kirk Douglas in it, which they were very outspoken against them. That's what the whole I Am Spartacus is about, like not ratting, you know, and everyone had to die together. So it's kind of cool watching the battle back then. Do you really think Jimmy Stewart was not going to name names, though?
I got it. Well, I guess really? I would sit there and look at it, though, too. It would like, OK, I'll get used as a point. Reagan knew I can't say anybody's name up there. I got to take, you know, I got to sit. But he also
had something else going on. Reagan. I watched something about a documentary about the Hollywood 10. And they said Reagan was doing something. But maybe I'm probably wrong on that. You're probably right.
Yeah.
What's the Hollywood 10?
That's the 10 writers that got arrested for, you know, the blacklist of communists, the ones who actually went down for it. They all went to prison for like a year and stuff. And
yeah. So, Ron, how you'll know this, and I'll give you context, is Dalton Trumbo was the writer of Johnny Got His Gun, mm-hmm. was the video for Metallica's One.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Right.
So he's also wrote Spartacus. That was his first credit back. Yeah.
That's probably the biggest one that was like, that's the one all of us knew. That was the metaphor for the blacklist was Spartacus.
And I guess he was the one who also called out John Wayne for because Dalton Trumbo was actually like served, and he was like a war correspondent or something, like he was a war photographer or whatever. And when John Wayne was trying to put him down, I guess he called out John Wayne for being like a draft dodger.
Oh, wow.
Well, he wasn't the only one. Apparently the guys who were serving at the time, he did like it wasn't a USO show because they didn't have it then, but it was something like it where he came out like in his spurs with the gun belt on and everything too. He got booed off stage.
Oh, no. Oh, wow.
Because like, they were like, motherfucker, you're our age. You should be able to do it.
Well, to his credit, though, I was watching a thing about him, why he didn't go to war, and because John Ford always gave him shit about that. That's why John Ford, to the end, John Ford always gave him a little bit of shit about not going to war. Yeah. And because all those other guys, those directors all went, those five directors, they went and they fucking shot, you know, Battle of the Midway footage and all that stuff. But John Wayne's like, I smoke four packs of cigarettes a day. I'm not going to war. So it's like, I probably wouldn't go either there, Duke.
That's just good self-care there.
Well, okay, so this is going to get into more salacious rumors that aren't founded, but I do want to hear Vito's take, because Ron, John Ford probably made most of your favorite Westerns. So
okay.
And this, so he was always kind of painted as the like kind of the classic macho director, tough guy, John Ford. Now there are people who say he was a closet case that was in love with John Wayne, which is why John Wayne was always in his movies, but also why he always dug at John Wayne about that, because it was a way of bringing him down. Have you heard any of this before?
You know, no, I haven't, but it wouldn't shock me. You know what I mean? Anytime, if you're that macho, you're obviously, something's going on in your head, right? But like, I've I don't know. Like I love John Ford. Like I'm with you, Ron. Like, yeah. I mean, Stagecoach. I love John Ford. You know, The Searchers is probably, you know, maybe the best Western.
Yeah.
I love John Ford. And I read Harry Carey Jr.'s book. It's called In the Company of Heroes. And it's all about the stock company of actors that worked with him. And he talks about like him digging on Duke. And a lot of it, at least it from that point of view, Harry Carey Jr.'s point of view was, you know, Duke drank a lot and he was a dick to people. So I don't know if you know, John Ford caught up on that a little bit, was like, fuck this guy, you know, I'm like, I'm gonna fuck with him then a little bit. Like if you didn't like to drink, like if you quit drinking to get your life straight, like Duke looked at you as like a pussy. If a man didn't drink and smoke, he's a girl. And so Harry Carey kind of quit drinking, and he was like, him and Duke stopped talking for 2 years because he wouldn't drink anymore. So I think a lot of that too is John Ford just thought like, because John Ford is kind of tough, even though he's has his own thing, you know, pettiness to him, probably if you break down his career. But like, I think he just had it in for John Wayne because, you know, you're a director and you're watching these actors and you're watching these actors act all tough all the time. And after a while, it probably gets you a little bit, you know, especially guys like John Wayne.
Yeah, I can imagine that. Those guys that probably start trying to like be their character where they like maybe John Wayne was. Because he was a real, I mean, he was technically a cowboy. I mean, his family's from Arizona. He had a ranch and everything, too. So he knew how to ride a horse and do all that.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he was in that way a real deal. But I wonder, like, all the, you know, when he became, like, kind of a hero cowboy, he just started talking a bunch of shit. And somebody, and Ford was just like, oh, fuck this.
Yeah. You know, there was a few actors that they said, like, John Ford, for some reason, John Ford and Wayne had all this attitude and everything. There are certain actors that, like, for some reason, they didn't really fuck with. And Jimmy Stewart, like, they love Jimmy Stewart for what he did, but they still would met little jokes and stuff like that. But Richard Widmark, do you guys know who Richard Widmark was? Yeah, no one thought Richard Widmark. Yeah, like he would tell like Duke to shut the fuck up and stuff like that. And so like nobody ever fucked with him. Like he was one of those actors that like leave him alone, you know. And I think Lee Marvin was another one. That's why he was only in Liberty Valance, and you don't really see him too many times with that company, you know.
Wow.
But they said, have you guys ever seen the documentary on Netflix called Five Came Back? It's based off that book about the directors who went to World War II. It was George Stevens, Frank Capra. Yeah. John Ford, John Huston, and and who was the last one that went? God damn it.
I don't know. I knew about Ford. Was it Cougar?
No, it was five directors. Was it William Wyler? I can't remember who the last one was.
It was five directors. It was Wyler. I think you're right.
And they said that John Ford was... He was the one who did all his guys are the ones who shot all the D-Day footage. So they said after that happened, they said John Ford was like locked up in a hotel room, just drunk. And he was all fucked up in the head after that.
I heard they had serious PTSD. I mean, they were in the shit.
Yeah.
And honestly, you could argue they probably in more danger because they didn't really have, they weren't defending themselves. They're shooting shit.
Yeah. They didn't have guns. They had cameras. Yeah. It's like Russ Meyer. You guys, like, you ever know that about Russ Meyer? Like, Russ Meyer was a giant, the best cameraman from World War II. He served under General Patton. And actually, if you watch the movie Patton and you see all the World War II footage that actually is real footage, that's actually Russ Meyer's footage who shot the...
Get out of here.
Yeah, Russ Meyer shot it.
He's my hero.
I know.
No wonder he did nothing but tits. He was like, I'm done with dead bodies.
But they said he was like a commander, is like a director. Like he'd shoot guns in the air. Like, you know, there's certain directors like John Ford, Samuel Fuller, even Russ Meyer. They're like that. And Jimmy Stewart reminds me of that kind of actor who needs that director who's like the general, you know?
Yeah. That's because, I mean, that's the thing, too. When you look at like, well, like, I haven't seen every Jimmy Stewart movie, but I've seen enough that I, you know, I have enough of a sample and I know what I like and what I don't like that he does, too. And because like when I watch Philadelphia Story and I watch It's a Wonderful Life and every other goddamn thing that happened, you know, earlier in his career, too, it was there were always kind of these. He sounded like a 12-year-old, but he was like 35, you know. It's like, I was like, this sucks so bad. I'm like, why do you, like, when people like would say, you go, oh, I got to check out Mr. Smith went to Washington. I like Mel Gibson in the Simpsons version of Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. you get to Rear Window, you know, that's a very creepy character. I mean, like, it's such a, I mean, Ron, did we watch Rear Window in college?
Not that I recall.
I thought we watched it together before, Ron. I thought we watched that and Vertigo at the Duplex before.
We might have. You guys watched a lot of crazy movies back then. Yeah.
Anything we could find.
They're watching, like, what the hell is this piece of shit?
I was telling someone who doesn't believe me that we literally paid $50 for a VHS of Terror Train because we couldn't find it. I mean, that's just the way it was back then.
There were so many questionable choices.
Yeah. Questionable. I'd do the same today. Let me ask you guys a question then about, we're kind of talking about his movies and stuff. And Vito, you alluded to this earlier. And this is kind of more of the business of movies. Why aren't Jimmy Stewart movies on streaming services?
Yeah, that's a good point. And it's funny, you know, so Criterion, I kind of hate Criterion right now because they kind of fucked with French Connection. But
we'll never let it go. I'm just going to call it right now. Ask him that same question in 30 years, Ron. He's going to give you the same answer.
Fucking Criterion. But Criterion did recently put out a thing with the Jimmy Stewart, Anthony Mann collection of all the Westerns they did. But besides, you're 100% right, besides the Hitchcock movies, Jimmy Stewart is basically buried. And you know, there's no reason why. Like, people nowadays, they talk shit about John Wayne. They try to, like, you know, cancel him or whatever. But Jimmy Stewart never really did anything wrong. Mm-hmm. He's just the most unexciting actor to this new generation. And it's like, you're right. You look him up, he did over 100 movies. But really, maybe 4 or 5, including It's a Wonderful Life, will last the test of time. You know, maybe 4 or 5.
Yeah.
Crazy.
Yeah,
it's crazy to think that.
Yeah,
I didn't know this too. Vertigo was I didn't know it was a flop.
Yeah,
that almost ended his career.
Yeah, ain't that weird? And it was fuck. But I tell you, I'm one of the few people that I love Vertigo in its own right, but it's definitely a little overrated to me. It's not my favorite Hitchcock. It's probably number 5. Where I love Rear Window. It's probably the best. You know?
I hope you get so much hate mail for that Vertigo.
it's great. It's great, but it's a little bit too much like trick and coloring. And where Rear Window is story, you know, it's about the story and that's everything. And Rear Window, I mean, Vertigo is too many tricks. And I don't know. It's all right. It was good. It's a great movie. It shouldn't have been Sight and Sound's number one movie of all time back in 2012 or whatever. But I was like, what the fuck is that?
Juan, those are two good flicks. Those are two good flicks.
Yeah, definitely. Like,
if you want a movie night. I will say, so this is how people change. I will still say, Vertigo, I will still put up there as one of my favorites. But the one thing that did change the last time I saw it, so I probably went about 20 years in between seeing them. So like 20 years ago, I had watched it. And I remember at the time thinking, Kim Novak is the most beautiful woman I've ever seen. I remember saying that to myself. I'm like, wow, what? I mean, you know. Would she really go for Jimmy Stewart? I'm not buying it, like, the whole time. And then I watched it this time around, and I'm like, what the fuck is going on with her? It is so fucking crazy. Like, I forgot the drawn-on eyebrows. That was a thing then. It was like,
oh, those eyebrows. Oh, my God. But San Francisco really is my favorite movie location for every, you know, one of them at least, you know, that and Monument Valley are like the two coolest spots you could shoot. And that's why I do love about Vertigo's locations, but I don't know.
I think it's kind of cool. When I was looking at Jimmy Stewart movies and stuff, you know, Rear Window, I just thought about how many times has that movie been parodied?
You're right.
I mean, Family Guy, like, you can name them on and on. I mean, everybody.
So many movies. There's a lot of movies that's just been remade. And they actually remade Rear Window back with Christopher Reeve. Remember that?
Yeah. No.
Yeah, when he's in his wheelchair. They just try to keep him working, so they redid Rear Window.
Yeah, everybody was like, we want them to be able to get out of the wheelchair. If you That's a big part of the movie.
Yes, indeed.
The original, though, that was the movie. So, yeah, going back to the art of film. My art of film teacher, and by the way, if any of the children are listening out there, if you just want to get a college degree, but you don't want to try too hard, communications media across the board, these are the classes you take. So art of film was the first class I had, though, that I actually went to. That was because most movie classes I didn't go to because they told you what movies you need to watch and I'd watch them. I didn't need anybody to tell me what I probably already saw them 10 times. But this was the one where he literally broke down Rear Window, like, frame by frame. We did that through over the course of a semester type of thing. That's where I finally started appreciating, you know, like, the older movies, especially the Technicolor age.
Yeah.
which I'm all about because that's all really saturated colors. It's not natural, but it looks great.
It'll never look like that again either.
Never again. And it was so good. So Rear Window was the first movie. And I love the fact, too, that in the 50s, you know, this famous photographer who broke his leg sitting at the window with this telescopic lens spying on neighbors, you know, that are dressing and doing shit. Mm-hmm. I'm like, this is a creepy movie. Really, if you
I'm so slow. It took me like my 12th time before I started realizing like what the movie was about. Like the different windows was like his view of like
it was his TV shows.
Yeah, but if you ever see Brian De Palma's body double, it's literally a combination of Vertigo and Rear Window.
So of all your episodes, I've only not listened to two. That one, body double, because I haven't seen it yet. So I
you never seen body double? Yes, you have.
I haven't. Well, I started watching Body Double.
Even we were little kids, you didn't watch it.
No. I never watched it.
God damn, I thought you did. Ron, have you seen Body Double?
That's what I'm trying to think here. I think I did. What's the plot?
It's the actor, out of work actor, and he's house sitting for a buddy who's like, yeah, this girl dances naked across the street every night at this time. And he's watching this girl dancing naked, and there's a guy in there trying to kill her, and he witnesses a murder. And But he has like this tunnel vision, like where he or this claustrophobia. So that's like his vertigo or whatever.
That's
so
his vertigo.
So it's like a cross between. It's fucking awesome. I love Body Double.
I watched the beginning of that and. For whatever reason, I didn't get a chance to finish it. It might have been when we were in Indiana, even because that's when we watched. What was the one with Michael Caine from De Palma?
Oh, that was Dressed to Kill. That's Dressed to Kill. Great.
So, yeah, that's a great one too. And so we got those around the same time. And Body Double, I didn't get a chance to. I probably was working in a movie theater or something, but I had to leave right when he saw the murder.
Oh,
that's when I had to go, and I just never got back to it. That and the other version of that is that John Travolta movie, Blowout.
Whatever. Yeah, all Brian called. De Palma. Brian De Palma was his thing. He was a Hitchcock guy for a long time, you know.
Yeah, and you wouldn't think Jimmy Stewart was the guy that was going to carry those movies, you know, if you heard about it on paper. But it just fucking worked, and somehow everybody just was okay with believing that Grace Kelly was just. He was just trying to shoo her away, Ron.
I know, right?
Kelly, Jimmy Stewart, old ass Jimmy Stewart, toupee and all, was just telling her, you know what? You're a drag. You know, you just got to go someplace else. I'm never going to marry you.
I was like, yeah, okay.
We all believe Bachelor there, right?
That's right. He was America's Bachelor. I do forget that. He was America's
Bachelor. That's right. Well, they said, even on High Noon, they said that Grace Kelly like to jump from lap to lap, tell the different old guys and stuff. So
what a cock tease.
Yes, we love you, Grace.
She knew exactly.
She knew. That's how she became the princess. Come on.
We need final thoughts.
We are on final thoughts.
Let me ask you a final thought, then, everybody.
Okay.
So we've covered a lot about Jimmy Stewart, good, bad, and indifferent. I've learned a lot. Hopefully everybody else has.
Yes.
A little plug for Vito's podcast here. But the true question, is Jimmy Stewart overrated, underrated, or perfectly rated?
I will say first, and I'll let Joe go real quick. I'll say you kind of answered it when you said he got buried. You don't know about him. No one knows about him anymore. So I'm going to say underrated because I still think he's not the greatest actor, but he's still a Mount Rushmore, just Hollywood icon. And I think he should still be relevant. And he only, like I said, he only has a few movies. So to me, he's underrated.
Okay.
He still gets love from actors today, though. Even younger actors still talk about him. But I will agree with you there, too, that when you, because you know, everybody creates the Mount Rushmore of, you know, every era, like a Hall of Fame kind of thing. We have our Tom Hanks, and you know, every era has characters that come out of it, and he was one of them. I mean, he was movies today, like especially with Hitchcock's Vertigo, and you get Rear Window. Those are very modern movies. Those could you make those in 2023 and everybody would be just as interested in it.
Right. But when they talk about those, they talk about Alfred Hitchcock. You know, very rarely is it the Jimmy Stewart movies.
But
he
was necessary, though.
I agree with you. Yeah.
Because you look at Vertigo, you needed kind of a guy you would believe that would be like, honestly, kind of a stalker by the end of it, too. Obsessed with a woman. But somehow in Rear Window, you know, he could barely even acknowledge that there was a woman in the house, in his apartment with him, too. So, but he pulled that off. And his character, because he was kind of feeble and weak and older, it made it work better as well, too. Mm-hmm. Especially when Raymond Burr comes up. I don't want to do spoilers, Ron.
Yeah, just got to watch that one, Ron. Definitely. I think you'll really like both of those, Rear Window and Vertigo.
Yeah, satisfying watches regardless. And that in and of itself makes you Hollywood royalty, that if you have movies that you can turn on and you'll watch it no matter where you pick it up at, that's a classic. And he has multiple of those.
Now, the title of it is Beau. That's the name of the dog. He never came to me when I would call unless I had a tennis ball or he felt like it. But mostly he didn't come at all. When he was young, he never learned to heel or sit or stay. He did things his way. Discipline was not his bag, but when you were with him, things sure didn't drag. He'd dig up a rose bush just to spite me, and when I'd grab him, he'd turn and bite me. He bit lots of folks from day to day. The delivery boy was his favorite prey. The gas man wouldn't read our meter. He said we owned a real man-eater. He set the house on fire, but the story's long to tell. Suffice to say that he survived and the house survived as well. And on evening walks, and Gloria took him, he was always first out the door. The old one and I brought up the rear because our bones were sore. And he'd charge up the street with Mom hanging on. What a beautiful pair they were. And if it was still light and the tourists were out, they created a bit of a stir. But every once in a while, he'd stop in his tracks and with a frown on his face, look around. It was just to make sure that the old one was there to follow him where he was bound. We're early to bedders in our house. I guess I'm the first to retire. And as I'd leave the room, he'd look at me and get up from his place by the fire. He knew where the tennis balls were upstairs, and I'd give him one for a while, and he'd push it under the bed with his nose, and I'd dig it out with a smile. But before very long, he'd tire of the ball, and he'd be asleep in his corner in no time at all. And there were nights when I'd feel him climb upon our bed and lie between us, and I'd pat his head. And there were nights when I'd feel this stare, and I'd wake up and he'd be sitting there, and I'd reach out to stroke his hair, and sometimes I'd feel him sigh, and I think I know the reason why. He'd wake up at night and he would have this fear of the dark, of life, of lots of things. And he'd be glad to have me near. And now he's dead. And there are nights when I think I feel him climb upon her bed and lie between us. And I pat his head. And there are nights when I think I feel that stare, and I reach out my hand to stroke his hair, and he's not there. Oh, how I wish that wasn't so. I'll always love a dog named Beau.